Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh and we are going to start our daily current affairs. So today you have 5th of February 2021 and we are going to start our daily classes for your current affairs. These classes are meant for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination as well as other government competitive examinations. You can always refer our classes, follow and subscribe the Future IAS on YouTube. We are here for your preparation, for your enhancement in your preparation, and we are bringing here for your day-to-day current affairs every day. All right. So we are basically following the two national newspapers. The first is The Hindu and the second is Indian Express. All right. These two national newspapers we are following. And you should also follow these two national newspapers for your civil services preparation as well as for the other government competitive examination preparation for your the coverage for your daily current affairs. All right, so begin with the lecture. Okay, so first of all, the MOU for composite raw materials, right? So here the composite material is something which is made up of, you know, different constituents, right? Or here the constituent material is basically, you know, more than one. So that is made up of, or that is called basically the composite material. The composite material has the industrial applications, like it can be used in, say, manufacturing of the airplanes and otherwise other, you know, the industrial applications. So it has huge, you know, the manufacturing as well as industrial, you know, significance for production line, in the production line as well as other, in the manufacturing process. So here the Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, along with the Mishra Dhatu Nigam Limited, which is again, you know, the PSUs, both have signed a memoranda of understanding, right, for the development and production of composite raw material. Okay, so both of these PSUs, Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, HAL, and Mishra Dhatu Nigam Limited, Medani, both have signed a MOU for the development and the production of these composite raw materials, right? And these MOUs were signed during the Aero India 2021, which was going on. Right, on 4th of February 2021, right? So it is the first time that such MOU for the production and the development for such raw material, right, consisting of the composite, is basically signed. So it is the first such MOU which was signed between the two PSUs for production and the development of the composite raw material, which will have the industrial and the production significance. Okay, so as I told you that the composite raw material can be used, right, or can be in the form of, for example, a carbon, right? It can be in the form of aramid, the glass types, right? So you have the different forms of the composite raw material, and it can be used for various, manufacturing process. Like, first of all, light combat aircraft, right? It will have some of the properties, some of the physical properties, along with chemical properties, with the requirement, right? So you can basically, you know, mold the composite raw material as per the requirement of, say, light combat use in the light combat aircraft, advanced light helicopters, because such a raw material or such a composite raw material would definitely, because it consisting of the composite, that means it will have more than one constituent which will have certain significant physical and the chemical properties. So obviously we will have certain set of material for the production line for building of advanced lighter helicopter as well as, you know, combat aircraft. It will also be used for the light combat helicopters, right? It will also be used for the light utility helicopters, which are currently imported, right? So it will have the huge impact on, first of all, on the Make in India program, as well as the reduction of the dependence on certain foreign countries for the import of these light combat aircraft, advanced light helicopters, light combat helicopters, as well as light utility helicopters. So if that raw material is available in India, right, it can be, or these type of light combat aircrafts or helicopters can be manufactured, right, can be produced in India, and which can also be having some sort of a linkages with the export from the India also, because it can definitely boost the export of such light combat aircrafts on India, if such composite raw material is being produced in our country. All right. So the uses of these composites basically lies in the aerospace, in the aerospace field, where, you know, obviously, because you need in the different warfare footings, you need basically the light combat aircraft, which can easily take off, which can easily, you know, land, and which can easily maneuver during the case of war. So the significance of such composite will definitely going to increase in the future also, right? Because it has certain inherent advantage over the metallic raw materials. The metallic raw materials having, you know, some sort of a the drawback in terms of the radar interception, right? So you know, you may have certain set of, lay, you know, not coming within the radar if you use basically composite raw material. So you will have the some of the stealth features basically by the uses of these composite raw materials, right? So which will have definitely, you know, the impact on the overall security of our country. Okay, next, the Rashtriya Yuva Sashaktikaran Karyakram. Okay, so it's basically the National Youth Empowerment Program, right? Sashaktikaran. So Rashtriya Yuva Sashaktikaran Program. So first of all, you must understand, it is a central sector scheme which was definitely implemented by, you know, the Ministry of Youth Affairs and the Sports. So it was implemented by the Government of India. Okay, so this Rashtriya Swasthya Sashaktikaran Karyakram, which was implemented. So in the Lok Sabha, the Minister of State for the Youth Affairs and the Sports informed Lok Sabha about Rashtriya Yuva Sashaktikaran Karyakram, the details about this scheme. Okay, and the budget allocation which was there for 2020 and 2021 for Rashtriya Yuva Sashaktikaran program was 486 crore, which was allocated during 2020 and 2021. Okay, as I told you, it is a central sector scheme, so it is a umbrella scheme, right? The seven schemes which were there previously, which was subsumed, right, under Rashtriya Yuva Sashaktikaran Karyakram. So these seven schemes are basically the Nehru Yuva Kendra Sangathan, which was previously implemented, the National Youth Corps, the National Program for Youth and Adolescent Development, okay, the International Cooperation in the Youth Development, Youth Empowerment, the Youth Hostels, the Assistance to Scouting and the Guiding Organizations, and the National Youth Leaders Program, right? So these are some of the seven sub schemes which comes under the Rashtriya Yuva Sashaktikaran Karyakram or program. Okay, next is basically the roadways and alternate mobility solutions. Okay, so roadways, you know that in some of the hill stations, right, or some of the far flung stations where the topographical features are very complex, right, it is not possible to construct the roads or, you know, the airports or, you know, helipads over there, or the train services are not there. So the alternate path to reach over such regions. Apart from that, you may have also significance in terms of the tourism also. So the roadways are basically, you know, one of the paths or one of the means of the transportation which basically we use in the certain areas, let's say in the hilly areas, right? So for the transportation purpose, for other transportation purpose, for the goods and services also. So they are basically alternative mobility solutions which are implemented throughout the country. Okay, so here the Ministry of Road Transport and the Highways, right, will now look after the development of roadways and the alternative mobility solutions. Obviously, it is a part of any sort of a transportation, and transportation is a subject comes under the Ministry of Road Transport and the Highways. So obviously, it comes under the domain of Ministry of Road Transport and the Highways. And now the Ministry of Road Transport and the Highways will now look after such development of alternative mobility solutions. All right. Now, the Ministry of Road Transport and the Highways will look after the construction of such roadways or alternative mobility solutions. It will also look after the research for such alternative mobility solutions, as well as it will try to bring policy, right, in this area, right? And the Ministry of Road Transport and the Highways also, right, would formulate the institutional development for the development of such mobility solutions. It will try to provide the financial framework for the development of such alternative mobility solutions, as well as the regulatory framework, right, for the technology which we basically, you know, we use for such roadways. All right. And obviously, if we develop the alternative mobility solutions like roadways, it will definitely boost, you know, the tourism potential, as well as definitely it will also, you know, setting up of the regulatory design. And that will further boost the research and the new technology, right, which can be basically utilized for the development of these mobility solutions. All right. The amendment to the Government of India under the allocations of the business rules 1961 have been notified. right? So this notification basically enables the Ministry of Road Transport and the Highways to look after the development of roadway, ropeways, as well as the alternative mobility solutions. So this amendment to the Government of India Rules 1961 enabled the Ministry of Road Transport and the Highways to look after such development. All right, so it is basically roadway. You can see basically these are the taxis where the people are basically used, especially in the, you know, hilly terrain areas where there is, you know, some sort of a scope of the tourism as well as other transportation network. All right, next, the power sector reforms. So the reforms have been, you know, continuously going on in the power sector, which is the most important, you know, core sector. Now the central government is providing, you know, various incentive to the state government regarding the reforms which undertake in the power sector. So such reforms are very much essential. Okay, and such reforms are basically promoted and originated from the Government of India. So here the Department of Expenditure under Union Ministry of Finance have provided certain incentives to the state government regarding the reforms in the power sector, right? If they comply, they means if the states comply with those reforms if the state undertake those reforms, definitely, you know, certain incentives are provided to those states regarding they can basically arise, for example, extra incentive or extra, you know, financial resources from the market. Right. So with certain percentage, certain incentives have been provided. So here, apart from the Madhya Pradesh, the Andhra Pradesh have become the second state in our country to undertake the power sector reforms in India. Okay. As it was stipulated by the Department of Expenditure under Ministry of Finance. Okay. So here you must understand the Andhra as well as the Madhya Pradesh both have undertaken the power sector reforms as was stipulated by the Ministry of Finance. So as I told you, it's a part of reform, okay, so where the state has started direct benefit transfer. Okay, DBT is the process by which you are directly transferring those resources, right, to the account of, say, stakeholders. So here the farmers. So here the state started basically direct benefit transfer of the electricity subsidy. For example, for a particular village, let's say electricity subsidy, say 30% or 40%, I'm just giving an example. So if that amount is directly transferred to the farmers, right, to the farmers' bank account, that is called basically DBT of electricity subsidy, right, that have effect from September 2020. So that was the reform and that was implemented, right, and the states has successfully implemented one out of the three stipulated reforms in the power sector as was stipulated by the Department of Expenditure under Ministry of Finance. Okay, as I told you that both Madhya Pradesh was the first state and after that Andhra Pradesh become the second state. Both have undertaken the reforms, right, in the power sector in this reform. All right, regarding the background, as I told you, the background is basically very important because the DISCOMs are basically heavily, you know, in the depth, and there is, you know, irregularities also in terms of providing those reforms. So here the guidelines are issued by the Department of Expenditure, okay, under Ministry of Finance, right, which basically incentivize the state government to undertake certain reforms, especially in the power sector, right? If they undertake the reforms, right, and successfully conducted the reforms, they will be granted, or the states will be granted the permission to raise the additional financial resources up to 0.25% of gross state domestic product, that is GSDP, gross state domestic product, right? So here, if the state undertake, you know, the bare minimum reforms as was stipulated by the Department of Expenditure and the Ministry of Finance, such state would be, you know, granted a permission to raise additional financial resources of 0.25% of gross state domestic product from the market. All right, so here the three reforms which was undertaken or which was stipulated by the Department of Expenditure under Ministry of Finance. So here it is 0.05. It is 0.05. Okay. So 0.05% of the GSDP or gross state domestic product in terms of reduction of the aggregate technical and the commercial losses in the state, right? If, you know, the state is undertaking the reduction in terms of the aggregate technical and the commercial, the losses, the state can take up 0.05% of the GSDP, right, it can raise. Second, the 0.05% of the GDP is allowed for the reduction in the gap between average cost of supply and average revenue realization, right? For example, if average revenue realization is lesser than average cost of supply, okay, what will happen? There will be gap, or there will be, you know, not sustainable, you know, the revenue generation. So idea is, if the average cost of supply is lesser and average revenue realization is more, or we should reduce the gap. We should reduce the gap. Obviously, the revenue realization is not good in India. The DISCOMs are facing very high stress. Okay, so the cost of supply is very high and revenue realization is low. So if percentage of gross state domestic product. Okay, the third such reform which was there in terms of 0.15% of the GSTP, if the state undertake the direct benefit transfer to the farmers, right, in terms of the free and the subsidized electricity. Okay, so if the DBT is, you know, implemented to the farmers account directly, right, the state will be allowed to take, you know, 0.15% of the GSTP. Okay, so here the state government has to frame a scheme, right, and under this scheme the state government has to stipulate to what manner the transferring of the cash would be there, would be done in the accounts of the farmers, right, and how they implement the scheme at least in the one district by 31st of December 2021. Okay, so here the state has to, you know, first of all formulate a scheme or frame a scheme for the transferring of the cash, and they should implement the scheme at least in the one district. So that is, for example, if any state consisting of 31 districts, in at least one district such scheme should be implemented by December 31st 2020. So that is the third such, you know, reform which was stipulated by the Department of Expenditure under Ministry of Finance. So aggregately you can say 0.05% of the GSDP, 0.05% of GSDP in basically the two, in the first two, and 0.15% of GSDP in the case of third. Okay, next, Kapila. So what is Kapila? First of all, Kapila means, it is basically a Kalam program for intellectual property literacy and awareness campaign. So it is, short name is Kapila. Okay, the Kapila is basically a campaign which was launched by the government of India. Okay, so it is a campaign which was launched by the government of India, right? Ultimate purpose is to, you know, is to proliferate the literacy related to the intellectual property rights, right? So to literate the people in terms of intellectual properties, right, as well as to create the awareness in terms of patent, in terms of patent, okay, on 15th of October 2020. So it is basically a awareness campaign, you can say, right, or a literacy campaign which was started by the government of India, right, for, you know, for creation of the literacy related to the intellectual property rights, as well as building of awareness related to the patents. All right, so here the objective, or few objectives of the scheme of the Kapila, is basically creating the awareness regarding intellectual property rights, right? So to the mass, it should be, you know, creating the awareness to the people, right, especially in the higher education institutions like IITs, right, and you have other, you know, higher education institutions, right, so that the awareness is generated regarding intellectual property, right, it can boost further any sort of research and the development in terms of IPRs. Okay, then enable IP protection, intellectual properties protection of the inventions originating from the faculty and the students of higher education institutions. Obviously, there is a breach of the intellectual property rights, right, not only in India but also in throughout the world. So if you provide the protection to such intellectual property rights, right, that will boost the inventions, especially from the faculty and the students of higher education institution, and that will motivate them to further, you know, to do certain research and development to further invent, you know, the new technology related to, you know, intellectual properties, right? And here development of the credit course on the IPR, right? So here certain course related work will also be there. So credit course will also be implemented on the IPR, right? Then training program, this is very, very important on the IPR. So training program both for the faculty and both for the student, so that they can sensitize themselves, they can aware themselves, right, they can build, because the literacy is something different, but to create certain set of awareness related to intellectual property, that is different. So for that you need sensitization program, you need a training program, right, so that you may have the, you know, certain set of, you know, awareness in terms of the faculty and the students of both higher education institutions, right? Then you need to create the sensitization drive, the development of vibrant IP filling systems, right? Then only the people will be motivated to enough to register their, you know, the invention as well as to promote further research and development in this regard. All right. Next, FIVES vision. So what is that FIVES vision, first of all? So here you must understand that the Indian Ocean region, that is basically the region belongs to the Indian Ocean, or the region which is basically encompassing your Indian Ocean. Okay. So here the Defense Minister's Conclave basically began. Okay. So that Defense Minister Conclave basically began with a keynote of our Defense Minister, who is basically Shri Rajnath Singh, on the 4th of February 2021 on the sidelines of Aero India 2021 in the Bangalore. Okay, so it was a conclave. Okay, and the India is the largest nation in the Indian Ocean region, right? And India has the vast coastline of around 7,500 kilometers that you people knows already about it. Okay, and India has the, you know, the responsibility not only to protect its own, you know, the coastline, but also the overall security provider in the Indian Ocean region, right? So India has the active role to play in terms of peaceful and the prosperous coexistence of all countries, and to nullify and neutralize any threat originated in the Indian Ocean region, and to overall provide the overall security provider in the region, sensitize and aware the countries in this regard, right? As well as the cooperation and the coordination in those countries which belongs to the Indian Ocean region. So the India is basically having the tremendous role in terms of the cooperation and coordination among all the countries, and ultimately to provide overall security provider in this region. Okay, for that, the SAGAR is security and the growth for all in the region, which was implemented, right, as the Indian Ocean policy, which was outlined by the Prime Minister Narendra Modi in 2015. The ultimately aim is to provide the overall security cover to the Indian Ocean region, right, and the growth for all who are basically the countries which are there in the Indian Ocean region. And India's approach in this regard is basically very, very clear, that to tackle the global challenges which are facing by the Indian Ocean region, not only about Indian Ocean region, there is also challenges, say, South China Sea also, where China is expanding. So there is a threat from the China also. So Chinese aggression is one of the threat, not only in the South China Sea, but also in the Indian Ocean region also, right? So to tackle such type of global challenges which we are facing, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi's, you know, the dynamic 5S vision. So these are basically dynamic 5S vision, which are, given by the Prime Minister Narendra Modi. So that is, first is basically Samman. Samman means it is a Hindi word of respect, right? So we should give the respect to every other stakeholders in the Indian Ocean region, right? So the respect is one such S, right? Under the dynamic 5S vision, which was there with the Narendra Modi. Then Samvad, that means a dialogue. That means all stakeholders, all countries which are there in the Indian Ocean region should have the proper dialogue, right? Through the dialogue, we should resolve, or we should try to resolve all outstanding issues between the countries, all right? Then Sahyog means cooperation. So here, the cooperation is essential for overall development of this region. If we do not cooperate with each other, obviously, the overall development or fruits of the development may not be harnessed, right? So for that, the cooperation is very, very essential for overall security, you know, and safety of this region. Then Shanti, peace. So peace is also one of the important factor. We should always maintain a peace and decorum in the Indian Ocean region. And we should not threaten each other, you know, territorial integrity, right, by venturing into others, you know, the domain without taking the permission. So we should always maintain peace and decorum. Okay. Then Samriddhi. Samriddhi means prosperity. So here the prosperity means when we will have all sort of a, you know, dynamic five division, definitely we will have the prosperity in this region also. So we should try to build that type of relationship in this region so that it can boost the prosperity in this region. Then ultimately the people or the countries will also be prosperous in this region. Okay, so this is the basically region of Indian Ocean region. Okay, then the disputes on the projects of Krishna and the Godavari River. Okay, so here you must understand both of these rivers are basically disputed, right, because of certain developmental projects which are implemented by the Telangana and the Andhra Pradesh. Okay, so what happens is the government of Telangana as well as the government of Andhra Pradesh. Both have recently bifurcated in 2014. You might be aware about it by Andhra Pradesh Reorganization Act, okay, 2014. And after that, a Telangana state was basically originated. So now the Telangana, which was originally a part of Andhra Pradesh, now have become a separate state. So since now they become separate states, so government of Telangana and government of Andhra Pradesh both have basically mutually complained against each other, right? Telangana has complained about Andhra Pradesh and Andhra has complained about Telangana. Both have started a new projects on the Krishna and the Godavari rivers without submitting their detailed project report to the Krishna River Management Board and the Godavari River Management Board. Okay, so these are the management boards which were set up, right? Or these are statutory board which was set up, right? For, you know, for resolving certain issues, right? For technical, you know, issues. So here the detailed report or the detailed project report should be submitted to the management boards respectively of the Krishna as well as Godavari River. So both have complained to the Krishna River Management Board as well as Godavari River Management Board that the either side or either government, you know, has not submitted the detailed project report, and without submitting the detailed project report, they have basically started building the project. Okay, so that is the issue basically recently have been facing. So an Apex Council was constituted basically through AP Reorganization Act in 2014, at that time when Andhra Pradesh was bifurcated into the Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. Okay, and this Apex Council will be deciding the water related interstate matters, right? The meeting which was held regularly, the second meeting of such Apex Council, which was held on 6-10-2020, and which was chaired by the Union Minister of Jal Shakti, okay, along with the Chief Ministers of Telangana and the Andhra Pradesh, okay. And in that meeting, in that second meeting, it was decided that the both of these states, that means Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, would submit the detailed project reports of the new project. Whatever the projects they are going to implement, right, they should submit these detailed project report to the Kaveri River Management Board as well as to the Godavari River Management Board. If the project is on Kaveri River, obviously to the Kaveri River Management Board. If the river is on the Godavari, then Godavari River Management Board for further appraisal and the subsequent sanction by the Apex Council, right? So the Apex Council will look after any sort of irregularities in the framework of such project, and it will have subsequent sanction also. So to for the appraisal, they should submit the detailed project report. But what happens is both of these states have been complaining against each other that both of these states have not submitted the detailed project report about the project to the Krishna River Management Board as well as to Godavari River Management Board in that respect. All right. So you can see it is the basically map of Andhra and the Telangana, which was previously, you know, a unified state. Okay. Next, micro irrigation. So micro irrigation, you people knows about. It is basically irrigation, or it is the method of irrigation by which we use basically some sort of a sprinkling system, sprinklers or the drip system. That means we try to save the basically the loss of water through the seepage or through, you know, evaporation. Ultimately, we try to reduce the loss of the water. Okay, so for that we use basically micro irrigation. The micro irrigation is very beneficial for horticultural crops, right, as well as to certain regions where the water deficit is very, very high or there is water shortage, right? So here the Department of Agriculture Cooperation, the Farmers Welfare, that is DAC and FW, is basically implementing the central sponsored scheme that is called Per Crop, Per Drop, More Crop, which is a component of the Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sinchai Yojana, okay, in all states from 2015 and 16. Okay, so it is basically a part of the, it is part of your Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sinchai Yojana, which is basically under the banner of Per Drop, More Crop. That means you basically grow more crop per drop you spend of water in terms of irrigation. Okay, so ultimate aim was to enhance the water use efficiency, because the water use efficiency of the drip irrigation is very, very high. That is around 95%. Okay, that means 95% of the water is basically, you know, utilized in terms of the uses of water. Okay, so water use efficiency at the farm level, right, with respect to micro irrigation, you know, the networks are very, very high. Okay, these micro irrigations are basically drip irrigations and the sprinkler irrigation system. So sprinkler means you will have certain pole and the water will be sprinkled out. The water will be sprinkled out, and it is basically having some sort of a rotatory motion also. So this will rotate and the water will be sprinkled out to the outside. Drip irrigation means you will have field and you will have certain set of a network of the pipes. Okay. These networks of the pipe on the field. Okay. So this is, I'm just drawing a 2D diagram. You can understand. Okay. So there will be a network of the pipe. For example, this is basically, you know, points where the drips have been putting up. So water is coming. Okay. Along with, you can also build up the fertilizers. So this is basically where the plant is basically, let's say plant is growing here. So this drip is basically giving the water to this nearby areas only. So what will happen? The water is further, you know, saved from the loss. Here you will have some loss to evaporation also, but here there will be a minimum loss. There will be a minimum loss because there is no such sprinkling system. The water is directly applied to the root of the plant. That is why we call drip. So water is directly applied to the root of the plant, but here the water is not directly applied. The water is sprinkled out in the basically air, and the water will fall down in that process definitely, right? In the process definitely the water will be evaporated and there will be some loss of the water. So the water uses efficiency would further down. So the drip irrigation, the water uses efficiency is much, much higher, though the sprinkler irrigation system is also having higher irrigation efficiency. Okay. Now under this Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sinchai Yojana, the ultimate aim is to promote the micro irrigation. Okay. And that component promotes, you know, the micro level water storage or water conservation management activities. Okay. Ultimately, you know, to supplement the source creation for the micro irrigation. So obviously, if you have to have the some sort of a source for micro irrigation, you need to build that source first of all. Okay, so that will basically, you know, boost further through this micro irrigation systems. Okay, so that will further have certain set of aspect related to water storage, water conservation, water management activities in this region. Okay, and various efforts have been made to conserve this per drop more crop scheme. Sorry, with Atal Bhujal Yojana. Then, right? So here, the Namami Gange is districts. Pradhan Mantri Krishi Urja, you know, Suraksha Bhim Uthan Mahavihar, that is called PM Kusum. The water harvesting structures through watershed development component of Prime Minister Krishi Sinchai Yojana to propagate the micro irrigation systems intensively, right? So here, ultimate aim was to converse all such schemes, right? So that we can basically optimally utilize those resources which are there, right? Because every such schemes also having the component related to irrigation. So if we converse them, if we use them optimally, obviously we can have the economies of the scale as well as we will have the greater impact on the irrigation front. Okay. And in that respect, the impetus to the micro irrigation system will be further boosted. Right. So for that, the micro irrigation fund was a setup. This micro irrigation fund will have the corpus of around 5,000 crore rupees. Okay, that fund was created with the NABARD, okay, in 2018 and 19. Here, to this fund, the government of India provides 3% interest subvention on the loan which is extended to the state government under in the basically micro irrigation fund, right? So here the government of India provides the interest subvention. So ultimate aim was to create the infrastructure needed for the micro irrigation, because the government is trying to promote the infrastructure associated with the micro irrigation, because you cannot provide the micro irrigation without associated or without necessary supporting infrastructure. So first of all, for any irrigation programs to succeed, you must build infrastructure. Without infrastructure, you cannot successful, or you cannot make your scheme successful. For that, a micro irrigation fund was set up. Okay, so it is one such line. You can see basically, it is a sub-main line where the water is basically supplied, and it is basically the fresh valves and stock. The water is coming basically through these pipes that I have drawn. Basically, the water is basically, you know, pumped from the well. It will pass through these, you know, valves. These are all technical in the nature. So you need not to worry about it, but you must understand the water is coming, and it is coming through this pipe, and it again distributing through these networks into different channels. Okay, you will have the pipes. So these are basically some of the networks related to your drip irrigation systems. Okay, fine. Then World Cancer Day. So here, the India Post Mumbai region, in the collaboration of Tata Memorial Center, both in the Mumbai, released a specific cover on the World Cancer Day, which was celebrated on the 4th of February. Okay, so here, A specific cover was released by the Tata Memorial Center as well as the India Post, Mumbai. So here, the ultimate objective of this cover basically to save the millions of the preventable deaths caused because of cancer every year by raising awareness among the people, right? By pressing government also to take the action against the cancer promptly, okay? So here, this World Cancer Day, which was organized first of all by the Union for International Cancer Control, which is basically the UICC, basically an international non-governmental organization, okay? That basically, you know, set up in 1933, and it is basically based in Geneva, Switzerland, or its headquarters are basically based in Geneva, Switzerland, okay? And you must understand, it basically the international non-governmental organization, which basically help the health communities to accelerate the fight against the cancer, which is basically preventable if it is assessed in the early stage, okay, in the first stage itself. So it is preventable, right, by some medicines, right? So here, the origin of the World Cancer Day was established by the Paris Charter, which was adopted in the World Summit Against the Cancer for the new millennium in the Paris in year 2000, right? So it was decided in this Paris Charter that every year, 4th of February will be celebrated as the World Cancer Day, okay? In 2019, again, the international non-governmental organization, that is Union for International Cancer Control, launched a new three-year campaign, right, to control the deaths, you know, from the cancer, which is preventable deaths, that I am and I will. So it is a theme which was, you know, related to this three-year campaign, which was implemented by the Union for International Cancer Control, okay? And that theme, I am and I will, basically is a campaign which will basically call to take an action, right, for, you know, for personal commitment regarding, you know, the healthcare providers, right, and to take individual action, right, so that we can impact, you know, the future loss, or we can minimize that future loss related to preventable deaths. Okay, next is National Safety Council. So the National Safety Council was basically set up, right, basically set up at the national level by the government of India. Okay, so it was registered as a society. Recently, it was in the news because the Ministry of Labor and the Employment has appointed the CEO and the Managing Director of Larsen & Toubro, L&T, Larsen & Toubro, Sri S.N. Subramaniam, as a chairman of the National Safety Council for the period of 3 years. So the CEO and the Managing Director of L&T will be the chairman of the National Safety Council at the national level. So National Safety Council basically is a non-profit, self-financing apex body at the national level in India. The ultimate objective of the National Safety Council is to generate the movement on the safety, the health and the environment, to develop some sort of a movement and to sustain that movement on the safety, health and the environment. So idea is to have the safe, healthy environment at the national level. Ultimately, it is an autonomous body which was set up by the government of India under Ministry of Labor and Employment in 1965. Initially, the National Safety Council was registered as a society under the Society Registration Act 1860. Okay. Subsequently, it was registered as a public trust under the Bombay Public Trust Act 1950. So it is now a trust, right? It is an autonomous trust, autonomous body, which is set up by the government of India, precisely Ministry of Labor and Employment. It was registered as a public trust under Bombay Public Trust Act 1950. And he is basically Subramaniam, or S.N. Subramaniam, who is basically the CEO and the Managing Director of Larsen & Toubro, Larsen & Toubro, L&T, right? And he was basically recently been appointed as the chairperson of National Safety Council for the period of 3 years. All right. So thank you very much for this session. We'll meet again tomorrow for our next current affairs. So till then, thank you very much.